Hello students, welcome back to my channel. Now I am going to discuss this general curvilinear motion. So far we have discussed the rectilinear motion, that is the motion in a straight line. So what is curvilinear motion? So curvilinear motion occurs when a particle moves along a curved path, right? So when the particle is not moving in a straight path, when the particle is moving in a curved path, so then in that case the motion is called curvilinear motion, right? And since this path is often described in three dimensions, vector analysis will be used to formulate the particle's position, velocity and acceleration. So you people must know the vector analysis, right? So since if the particle is moving in three dimensions, so then what we will do is that we will use the vector analysis. In this section I will explain the general aspects of curvilinear motions, and then in the coming section we will discuss the three different types of coordinate system that we will use to analyze the motion of a particle when it is moving in a curved path, right? So now let's say that we have this particle, and the path of this particle is represented by this curve, right? And let's say that we are given the s of t function, right? So let's consider that a particle located at a point on the space curve defined by the path function. So let's say that we know this s of t function, right? So the position of the particle moved from a fixed point O will be designated by the position vector, right? So what we will do is that we will specify a point, we will specify a fixed point, and then we will specify the position of this particle from this center. Let's say that fixed point is, let's say, center. So then what we will do is that we will use a vector r to specify the position of this this particle, right? So let's say that this r is r of t, right? And this r, when this particle is moving along this this path, so what will happen is that the direction and magnitude of this r will change, right? So let's say that initially the particle was here, and after some interval this particle has, after some time this particle has traveled to this position, right? So then at this instant the position will be represented by this another vector, this r dash vector, right? So the r will change. So now at this instant this r dash has this direction, right? And at this particular point the r direction is like this, and then at this particular point the r direction is this, right? So the r is changing its direction and both its magnitude. Similarly, if we define the displacement for this particle, right? So if we define the displacement for this particle, so there is a change in the r, right? So suppose that during a small interval of time the particle moves a distance del s. Let's say that this particle travels from this point to this point in some delta t. So what happens is that it travels some displacement delta r, right? About from this point to this point, right? So about along this curve it has traveled delta s distance, right? So that change in r will be defined by this, that change in r. Let's say that initially the position of this particle was described by this r, and then after some time interval its position is described by r dash, right? So there is a change in the r, right, in the position vector. So what is that change? So that change will be, change in r will be equal to final r minus initial r, or we can say that final r, final position vector will be r plus delta r, right? So we can say it like this. So then r dash will be r plus delta r, and this delta r is the change in the position vector, right? So the displacement, so this will be the displacement, this delta r will be the displacement, right? The displacement delta r represents the change in the particle's position, and it is determined by vector subtraction, that is delta r is r dash minus r, right? So if you want to find this change, so then this is the vector subtraction, right? Remember that delta r is a vector, r dash is a vector, and this r is a vector, right? So then we will use the head to tail rule to find this delta r, right? So then we will draw r dash vector. So let me draw that r dash vector. So this will be that r dash vector, right? So this is that r dash, and then we will subtract that r vector. So what we will do is that we will take these are vector but in the opposite direction. So let's say that this is that r vector in the opposite direction, right? And let me and now if we put this negative r on the head of the r dash vector, right? So let's say that this one is the r dash vector and this is minus r, right? So the resultant will be delta r. So what will be the resultant? So the resultant will be from the tail of the first vector to the head of the last, right? So this will be r delta r. So as we can see that this is delta r, right? So here it is said that the delta r, the displacement delta r, can be determined by vector subtraction. So this is vector subtraction, right? So you people must know this vector methods, right? Or in other words, r dash will be equal to r plus delta r, right? So as we can see that if we add the r vector and then delta r vector, so what we will get? We will get the r dash vector, right? So as we can see, this is this r vector and this plus delta r. So if we add r and delta r vector by head to tail rule, so if we add both of these vector by head to tail rule, so what we should get? We should get r dash, we should get the final position. So then this r plus delta r, so what we get? We get this r dash vector. So remember that whenever we are finding the difference delta r, right? So delta r will be from the head of the initial r to the head of the final r. Let's see if I erase this now. So delta r is from the head of the initial position to the head of the final position. So this is delta r, remember, right? And now if you want to find the velocity of this particle when it has traveled from this position to this position, so then the velocity will be again, the average velocity will be the total change in displacement, or the total displacement divided by total time, right? So during the time delta t, the average velocity of the particle is total displacement divided by total time taken, right? So total displacement is delta r, right? So delta r divided by delta t. And if you want to find the instantaneous velocity, so what we will do is that we will decrease this delta t, we will take this delta t very close to 0, right? And consequently the direction of delta r approaches an tangent to the curve, right? So if we decrease this time delta t, so then what will happen is that there will be very small decrease in delta r, right? Or increase in delta r, the change in delta r will be very less. So let's say that after very small interval the particle is somewhere here, right? Let's say that this red arrow is now r dash. So now the change is very small, right? So when the change is very small, so then this delta r vector will be tangent to this curve, right? So this delta r will be like this. I cannot draw it since this is very small, right? But when this delta t approaches 0, so then delta r approaches the tangent to the curve, right? So here as we can see that this delta r is the chord of this curve, but when this change in r is very small, so then this delta r will be tangent to the curve, right? So this delta r will be somewhere here, this will be tangent to the curve, right? So as we can see that if we apply the limit, so then this velocity will be instantaneous velocity, and that limit will be delta t tends to 0, right? So if the time interval is very small, so then we will have instantaneous velocity, and then that instantaneous velocity will be equal to v equals to dr by dt. And since dr is I explained that when the time interval is very small, so then dr will be tangent to the curve. So this means that when the dr is tangent to the curve, so the direction of v is also tangent to the curve, right? So remember that the velocity direction is always the direction of the displacement, right? So whenever, if dr is tangent to the curve, so then velocity direction will be tangent to the curve. Now if you want to find the instantaneous velocity magnitude, so what we will do is that, as we can see that whenever the time interval is very small, so then delta r will be equal to delta s, right? So then the delta s and delta r will become equal, since the curvature of the curve becomes straight, right? So for very small intervals, this line, this vector delta r will be equal to delta s, right? So since there will be very small change in the curvature of the path, right? So as we can see that when delta t approaches 0, so then delta r will be equal to delta s, right? So as we can write that this v will be, or we can write when we apply the limit, so then dr will be equal to ds, right? So now here we can write that v average will be equal to, if we write that delta r by delta t, and for very small interval delta r will be delta s by delta t, and if we apply the limits, so then the instantaneous velocity, if we apply limits to this now, so then this limit will be delta t tends to 0, so then this will be delta s by delta t, and if we apply this limit, so then this will be ds by dt. So the velocity magnitude will be ds by dt. So this means that if we are given s of t curve, if we are given s of t function, so then we can take the derivative of this s of t function, so then we will get the velocity, right? So thus the speed can be obtained, the speed which is the magnitude of the velocity can be obtained by differentiating the path function s with respect to time. Similarly, if you want to find the acceleration of that particle, let's say that initially the particle was here and then after some interval the particle is located here, right? So let's say that at this particular point the velocity is v, and after some time t the velocity is v dash. So as we know that the acceleration is the change in the velocity, right? So the average acceleration will be the total change in velocity divided by total time, right? And that change in velocity will again will be equal to, that change in velocity will be equal to final velocity minus initial velocity. So again we will use the vector approach to find this delta v, or we can write that v dash will be equal to v plus delta v. So by head to tail rule we can write, we can find this delta v, or we can find this v dash, right? So let's say that this is that v vector, right? So v plus delta v, so this is the delta v, and that by head to tail rule this v delta v should be equal to v dash, right? So now as we can see, and now if you want to find v delta v, so then we have to subtract the v vector, so we have to reverse the direction of v, and then by head to tail rule we can get that delta v vector. So as I have told you people that delta r or delta v, if we want to draw the vector of delta v, so then it will be from the tail of the initial velocity, from the head of the initial velocity to the head of the final velocity. So as we can see, this is the direction of delta v. Now let's say that after some interval, let's say that this particle is located here, so then the velocity vector will be, let's say that this is the velocity vector now, and that this velocity vector should also be tangent to this curve, right? So let's say that this is v double dash. So now if we draw all these vectors, and if we fix the tail of all these velocity vectors at some point O, let's say that this is that point O, and if I draw that third v double dash vector, let's say that this is that v double dash vector. So if we join the heads of all these velocity vectors after some intervals of times, right? So then let's say that this is the head of this v vector, then this is the head of this v dash vector, and let's say that this is the head of this v double dash vector, and if we join all these points, so then this will give us another curve, right? And this curve is called hodograph, right? So here it is said that the curve is called hodograph, and when constructed it describes the locus of points for the arrowhead of the velocity vector in the same manner as the path s described the locus of points for the arrowhead of the position vector. So this blue line, this is the path of this particle, right? So this is the this gives us the head of the position vectors, right? So when we let's say that this is the origin, right? So let's say if I draw a position vector r, then after some interval we can draw another r dash, and then after some interval we can draw another position vector, right? So this is the locus of all the arrowheads of the position vector. So similarly, if we fix the velocity vectors at some point, and then if we draw the curve, so then this curve give us the position of all the arrowheads of the velocity vector. So then this is called S of T curve. So then this is called the this graph is called, or this curve is called Hodo graph, right? So this is called Hodo graph, and this is called S of T. This is called the path of the particle. So this is called path of the particle. So to obtain the instantaneous acceleration, then this is the average acceleration. So then average acceleration is equal to del v by del t. So to obtain the instantaneous acceleration, we have to apply the limit. We have to decrease this time interval, right? So we have to apply limit from delta t tends to 0. So then this will be delta v by delta t. So then this will become dv by dt. So acceleration will be equal to dv by dt, and and when the time interval is very small, so then the direction of this delta v will be tangent to this Hodo graph, just like the position vector, right? So when this interval is very small, let's say that if I draw another velocity vector, but after very small interval of time, so then this delta v vector will be tangent to this curve, right? So this means that the direction of the instantaneous acceleration will be in the direction of delta v, and when this delta v is tangent to this Hodo graph, so then this means that the acceleration direction will be tangent to this Hodo graph, right? So here it is said that to obtain the instantaneous acceleration, we have to take the time interval very small in the above equation, and in the limit delta v will approach tangent to the Hodo graph, and this will give us dv by dt, and the direction of the acceleration will be tangent to the Hodo graph, remember. And you people now know what is Hodo graph, right? So Hodo graph is the curve produced by joining the heads of the velocity vector, right? So acceleration will always be tangent to the Hodo graph. And if we write this acceleration as d by dt, and this is dv by dt, and now we know that velocity is ds by dt, so we can write that acceleration is d square s by dt square. So now if we take double derivative of the path function s of t, so then we can get the acceleration for this curvilinear motion. So now again and again I am telling you people that the acceleration acts tangent to the Hodo graph. Remember, acceleration will be tangent to the Hodo graph, and in general it is not tangent to the path of the motion. The acceleration will not be tangent to the path of the motion, right? So remember, the acceleration will always be tangent to the Hodo graph, but it will not be tangent to the path of the motion. The velocity will be tangent to the path of the motion. Now if you want to find the direction of the acceleration with the path, right? So what will be the direction of the acceleration when the particle is moving on this path, right? So we can find that direction. As we have said here, that the acceleration will be tangent to the Hodo graph, but it will not be tangent to the path of the motion. So what if we want to find the direction of the acceleration when the particle is moving along the path, right? So we can find that direction as well, right? So the acceleration direction is always in the direction of delta v, right? So if we write the acceleration, so as we know that the direction of the acceleration is always in the direction of the change in velocity, right? So if we find the vector of the change in velocity, so then that will give us the acceleration direction, right? So let me find that change. So this change will be v dash minus v, if we consider this diagram, right? So this will be v dash minus v delta t. So now if you find this change delta v vector, so that will give us the direction of the acceleration with this path, right? So this delta v will be v dash. So we will draw v dash vector, and then we will reverse the direction of the velocity, initial velocity. So let's say that this is the v vector that is in the opposite direction to this v. So this is minus v vector, right? So we will add minus v vector with v dash in order to get the delta v vector, right? So we will reverse the direction of velocity. So now I have reversed this velocity direction. So what I will do is that I will add this vector with v dash vector by using the head to tail rule. So I will move this negative v vector on the, and I will place it on the head of v dash vector, right? So let's say that this is that v dash vector. So then the acceleration direction will be along this vector, right? Since this is the delta v, right? So we can write that this is v dash, this is minus v, so then this is delta v. So the direction of the acceleration will be in the direction of delta v, right? So, and this is the direction of the acceleration. So we can say that this delta v is the direction of acceleration. So now the direction of acceleration will always be towards the center of the path of, towards the center of this path, right? So as we can see here that the direction of acceleration is towards the center of this path. Let's say that somewhere here is the center of this path curvature, right? So acceleration will always be acting towards the center of the path, right? So acceleration will be tangent to the hodograph and it will be acting towards the center along the path, right? Now we will discuss the curvilinear motion in the rectangular components. So let's say that an object is moving in this rectangular room. Let's say this is a rectangular room, and let's say that we have fixed one corner is the origin, right? So let's say that the initial position of the particle is here, and then after some delta t, after some time interval, the position of the particle is here, right? So the initial coordinates of these points are x1, y1 and z1, right? So this particle is at a distance of x1, y1 and z1 from the origin, and after some delta t, this particle is at a position of x2, y2 and z2 from the origin, right? So there is a change in the coordinates of this point. So whenever there is a change in the coordinates of this point, so this means that this particle has traveled from this point to this point, right? So then what we will do is that in rectangular coordinates, we will represent the position of this particle by an arrow from the origin, and the head will be from origin to this point, right? So we will represent the position of this particle by an arrow which will start from the origin and that will end on this particle, right? So that arrow will have three coordinates, that is x, y and z, right? So we will represent that r vector as these three rectangular components. This r vector, let's say that we represent this r vector. So then this r vector will have three components. One component will be along x, one component will be along y, and one component will be along z, right? So we can represent that r vector as xi plus yi plus zk. Now let's say that this the initial position of this particle is represented by r1 vector. So r1 will be x1 I plus y1 j plus z1 k, and similarly after some delta t, the particle is somewhere here, so its position will be represented by r2, and it will be x2 I plus y2 j plus z2 k, right? So delta r will be R2 minus R1, right? So we can find this delta R by using these two vectors. So then delta R will be X2 minus X1 into I plus Y2 minus Y1 J, and similarly plus Z2 minus Z1 K. So this will be the change in delta R, right? So we will represent the position of the particle by using the r vector, and it will have three components. And if you want to find the magnitude of that position, so what we will do, we will use the Pythagoras theorem to find the magnitude. The magnitude of the position will be x square plus y square plus z square under the root, and the direction of r is specified by the unit vector. So again, we can represent this r vector by its magnitude and ur, that is the unit vector. So this unit vector will tell us the direction of this r position vector, and this unit vector will be equal to r vector divided by its magnitude, right? So this is favor vector analysis, right? And if you want to find the velocity, so then what we will do is that we will find the corresponding changes, right? So delta r, this is delta x I plus delta y j n plus delta z k. And if the time interval is very small, so then the velocity, we can write that r delta r will be again this delta x I plus delta y j plus delta z k. And if we take the delta r by delta t, so if you want to find the velocity, so then velocity will be delta r by delta t. So we will divide all this delta r by delta t, right? So then this will be delta x by delta t I plus delta y by delta t j plus delta z divided by delta t k. And if we apply the limit, so then v will be equal to limits, and if delta t tends to 0, so then we will get the instantaneous velocity, right? So then we will apply the limits to all these, right? So limit tends to 0, delta t tends to 0. So this will give us the velocity as this delta x by delta t will become dx by dt I plus dy by dt and plus dz by dt. And this will be along j and this will be along k, right? So then we will be able to find the velocity like this. So once we know the position vector, so then we will find the velocity vector, right? So this is our position vector. And now if we apply, if let's say this is my r and this is x I plus y j plus z k. So we will take the time derivative of this dr vector. So this will be dr by dt. So dr by dt will be equal to, we will take the derivative of this. So then this will be x I plus y j plus z k. And if we take the derivative, so then this will be d by dt and this will be x I plus d by dt x y j, this is y j plus d by dt z k, right? So this, we will get it like this. So the velocity will be d by dt x I plus d. So when taking this derivative, it is necessary to account for changes in both the magnitude and direction of each of the vectors, right? So the magnitude is changing, right? For example, the derivative of the I component, if we find the derivative of this d by dt x and I, right? So both the direction and magnitudes are changing, right? Since the r is changing its magnitude and direction as well, right? So we have to account for both the direction and magnitude. So when we take the derivative of this, so then this will become d, this is the product rule for derivative. So this will be dx by dt into I plus x di by dt. And if the origin is fixed, right, if the origin is not changing, so then I will not change its position with time. So the position vector I will not change its direction if the origin is fixed. Always the change in x will be along this direction, and the change in y will be along y direction, and the change in z will be along z direction if the origin is fixed. So this means that we can, if this change is, there is no change, so this means that this is 0, right? So the second term on the right side is 0. So this whole term is 0. So then we are only left with dx by dt into I, right? So this means that the vx component of the velocity will be dx by dt. And if you want to represent that vector, so then this will be along I, right? So now this means that the velocity vector will be equal to vxi plus vyj plus vzk. And similarly, if we write only vx velocity vector, so then this is dx by dt, and vy will be dy by dt, and vz will be dz by dt, right? So whenever, if the particle is changing its position and if the coordinates, if all the coordinates of the particle are changing, so then it will have velocity in all three dimensions, right? Similarly, if the particle is only moving along x direction, right, so then the Vy and Vz will be 0, right? So if the y and z coordinates of the particle are not changing, so then Vy and Vz, the velocity along y and the velocity along z coordinate will be 0, right? And similarly, if you want to find the magnitude of the velocity, right, so the magnitude of the velocity will be Vx square plus Vy square plus Vz square under the root, right? So this will give us the velocity magnitude, right? So now, as we can see here in this book, that the Vx is, we can write this like this as well, right? So Vx is x dot. So x dot means first derivative, and Vy means y dot, and Vz is z dot, right? So we can write it like this. And the velocity magnitude is this. So V is Vx square plus Vy square plus Vz square. So this will give us the velocity magnitude. And if we want to represent this velocity as a vector, so then this will be velocity, and its unit vector will be like this. And as we have discussed in the previous section, that the velocity will always be tangent to the path, right? So the velocity will always be tangent to the path. Now if you want to find the acceleration, so now we have the velocity vector. So velocity vector is, again, if I write that velocity vector, so velocity vector is Vxi plus Vyj plus Vzk. We have this velocity vector, and if we take the derivative of this velocity vector, so then that will give us acceleration. So dv by dt will give us the acceleration of that particle when it is moving in a rectangular coordinate system, right? So then this will be dvx by dt, right? So dvx by dt along I plus dvy by dt along j plus dvz by dt along k, right? So this will be acceleration along x, this will be acceleration along y, and this will be acceleration along z, right? So this will be the acceleration vector. So this means that the acceleration ax will be equal to vx dot, or we can say that if we take double derivative of the position x, right? And similarly, ay will be vy dot, and this is equal to y double dot. Similarly, az, the acceleration along z axis is, will be equal to, this will be vz dot, and vz dot is equal to z double dot, right? So now if we are given x of t, y of t, and z of t function, let's say for a particular situation, if we are given x of t function, y of t function, and z of t function, so we can find velocity. So velocity Vx will be the derivative of this, right? So this will be d by dt x of t. So this will be x dot, right? And similarly, if we want to find the acceleration along x, so then we will take the derivative of this Vx. So d by dt, and this will be the derivative of Vx, or we can write that d by dt, and Vx is x dot, right? So this is x dot, and if we take double derivative, so then it will become x double dot. And similarly, Ay will be y double dot, and Az would be z double dot. And if we want to find the acceleration magnitude, so then the acceleration magnitude will be Ax square plus Ay square plus Az square under the root. So here we can see, right? So this is the magnitude, and direction is specified by, again, the unit vector. If you want to represent this A vector, so then it will be represented by A. This will be the magnitude, right? And the direction will be represented by U A. So again, the acceleration will not be tangent to the path, right? So it will be acting towards the center of a curvature, right? So the acceleration direction will be towards the center of the curvature at that particular instant, right? So that will be the direction of the acceleration. So I think this is enough for today's lecture, and I will solve some example on this concept, right?